worship with the First Church in Hartland on this, the first Sunday in June, June 4th. The year, in case you're interested, is 2023. I know it seems impossible, but here we are. And we have many announcements today, and the first thing I want to say is even though we do not have a choir, the summer is going to be rich with music, rich with special music, some duets, solos, quartets, and so if you are interested in singing or working with Rebecca during the summer, please let her know as the Spirit leads you, if the Spirit drops a song into your heart, please contact Rebecca and she will work with you. And since we don't have a choir, as you know, we don't tend to applaud when the choir sings or when Rebecca does a particularly beautiful piece. But we are so grateful, and so we are not responding to performance, but I would like a round of applause for our choir who dedicates so much time and energy and under Rebecca's direction to lead us into worship. So let's give them a round of applause. All glory to God. Amen. There are other announcements. I call your attention to that page in the bulletin because there are a number of announcements. So the first thing I'd like to say, which is probably not in that bulletin, is there are new directories. So Nick Lindgren, our office administrator, has prepared a new 2023 directory, and so please take one on your way out, or if you grab one on the way in, put it down under your pew so you're not reading it during a sermon, because that would not be nice. Alright, and there is fellowship after service today. We're so grateful for those who prepare fellowship for us. But we do want to give those people who have worked so hard for years to prepare that fellowship for you to have a rest. And so particularly for the next 3 months, June, July, and August, we are scaling back the feast that we prepared during fellowship, and we ask that you would all honor that. Don't just suddenly bring tons of things, okay? We want just one sweet and one savory for June. And July and August, the people who have prepared fellowship are not going to be doing it. So if you would like fellowship, you absolutely need to sign up to set up and then do something, okay? Everyone needs a rest now and then, and we want people to take a rest so that they don't get burned out, and then they don't want to do it anymore, and then they say, I've got to take a rest from church because it's just too much. So please honor that and honor the ones who have prepared fellowship for so long. I so appreciate that. There are other sign-ups in the fellowship hall. Please, if you want to bring flowers for the altar, just sign up for that. That would be awesome. Not necessary, but if you'd like to honor someone, if you'd like to celebrate a certain something, by all means, sign up to bring flowers. June 18th, we will be celebrating Sue Forsyth as on one of our awards. The Tim Root Award for exceptional service to this church throughout the years. Many of you have not met Sue. She's been sort of struggling a little bit with a form of dementia, but she is still very much part of our congregation, and I see Sue on a regular basis along with Bob, and they're going to be here on June 18th, which is also Father's Day, when we get to celebrate Sue, and so please join us on that day. On June 25th, I will have the honor and privilege of celebrating my mother-in-law's life as her minister and conducting her memorial service in Maryland. And so you will have the blessing of a guest minister. Bob Jappen is going to be preaching that day, and he is going to be doing something in line with the theme that I have identified for the weeks of June and July. And so that's going to be a wonderful, enriching time. So please join us on June 25th, and please continue to keep the Collins family in prayer as they grieve the loss of Betty. Our summer quest is in full swing. We, Colleen and Juliet and I and many others are working hard to, first of all, get things. We got some treasures yesterday, literally treasure chests yesterday, and we have a registration form online. So as adults, as parents, grandparents, aunts, and uncles, please inform your families of this wonderful opportunity for a life-changing week here at the parish hall as we transform the rooms of the parish hall into a treasure quest. So thank you for that. Are there other announcements? Yes, I'm coming. know, at our congregational meeting in late April, the congregation voted to pursue installing a restroom in the sanctuary. And with that, two committees have been formed, and they're still open to for others to join. One is the building committee, the actual construction committee, and Brett Watson heads that, and we're most welcome to talk with him about participating on that. We would so appreciate your help. He has a couple of others, but please talk with Brett. We want to move forward with that. And the other committee is the finance committee, and because I'm not afraid to ask for money, I'm on that committee. And I'm joined by a representative from Deacons and a representative from Missions at this point, Alan and Karen Hill. We will be working closely, and we would so appreciate any other help that you would like to give, ideas, etc., so that we have a coordinated effort towards funding this, because we do not want to burden the church finances with the entirety of the cost, which could range, you know, up to maybe $85,000 or $90,000. I will tell you that the council and the congregation, particularly the council, thought long and hard about this, and we kept thinking until we could come to a unanimous decision. And I really appreciate the Spirit of God hovering over the council as those deliberations were taking place, because we didn't start in agreement, but we ended in agreement. And that speaks to the Spirit of God working in our hearts. And so with that, I know that if this will be successful, that both committees will be successful in their functions. And so if you have any ideas, thoughts, please speak to Brett or myself or Rob Hanselder. Any questions? Brett, anything to add?
No, we just could really use some participation, though, because two or three people is okay, but it's better if we get more people involved with the church.
Are there other announcements? Then let us enter into a spirit of worship as we gather together in the stands and are able to sing Christians We Have Met With. It is number 277 in your hymnal.
Thank you.
celebrate communion today. Let us join together. Search my heart, Lord, as you know when I sit and when I rise. You discern my going out and my lying down. You perceive my thoughts and are familiar with all my ways. You created my inmost being. Your eyes saw my unformed body, and all the days of my life were written in your book before one of them came to be. Search me, God, and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
The scripture readings today are from John chapter 1, verses 1 through 18, and 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 11 through 14. Please find them printed in your order of worship. John. In the beginning there was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were made by him, and nothing was made without him. In him there was life, and that life was the light of all the people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overpowered it. There was a man named John who was sent by God. He came to tell people the truth about the light, so that through him all people could hear about the light and believe. John was not the light, but he came to tell people the truth about the light. The true light that gives light to all was coming into the world. The Word was in the world, and the world was made by him, but the world did not know him. He came to the world that was his own, but his own people did not accept him. But to all who did accept him and believe in him, he gave the right to become children of God. They did not become his children in any human way, by any human parents or human desire. They were born of God. The Word became a human and lived among us. We saw his glory, the glory that belongs to the only Son of the Father, and he was full of grace and truth. John tells the truth about him and cries out, saying, "This is the one I told you about. The one who comes after me is greater than I am, because he was living before me." Because he was full of grace and truth, from him we all received one gift after another. The law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the only Son, is very close to the Father, and he has shown us what God is like. 1 Corinthians. No one can really know what anyone else is thinking or what he is really like except that person himself. And no one can know God's thoughts except God's own Spirit. And God has actually given us the Spirit, not the world's Spirit, to tell us about the wonderful free gifts of grace and blessing that God has given us. In telling you about these gifts, we have even used the very words given to us by the Holy Spirit, not words that we as men might choose. So we use the Holy Spirit's words to explain the Holy Spirit's facts. But those who aren't Christians can't understand and can't accept these thoughts from God, which the Holy Spirit teaches us. They sound foolish to them because only those who have the Holy Spirit within them can understand what the Holy Spirit means. Others just can't take it in.
Would you pray with me? Holy God, we ask that you reveal yourself to us by your Holy Spirit. So may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So the Trinity is one of those concepts in Christianity that has caused much thought, many arguments, has inspired poetry, inspired music, and even formed the basis for denominations. We are Trinitarians, and we celebrate the Trinity today, and I hope, by the grace of God, that I can convey the importance of knowing the how and the why of the Trinity to the glory of God. As Paul would say, I may not speak with glorified language or sound educated and articulate, but I will speak of God in three persons to the best of my human ability. Actually, it will only be by the Spirit of God that I will be able to speak of this wonderful mystery of our faith at all. So let us begin. And I'll manage the trembling. Today we read from the Gospel of John, and each of the Gospels introduces Jesus in a different way. Matthew was a Jew, and he spoke to Jews. He gave the genealogy from Abraham down through Joseph. Abraham called God to be the first Jew. And he traveled those generations down to Joseph and refers to Jesus as Messiah, King of the Jews. Mark's perspective is that of a servant. Luke, a non-Hebrew, he was a Gentile. I'm not sure if anybody knows that, but he's not a Jew. And he speaks of Jesus from his humble birth back 77 generations, back into Mary's lineage, and presents Jesus as Son of Man and Savior to all. And John, our beloved disciple, clearly Jesus' favorite, John, the beloved disciple, begins with those famous words, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The Word was God, the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were made by him, and nothing was made without him. In him there was life, and that life was the light of all people. John goes on to make sure that it's clear that Jesus was God. And much later, the disciples, including Paul, make clear that Jesus died in his humanity for everyone, representing all humanity, that all might be saved and given eternal life. And not only that, but Jesus rose to assume his rightly godly position at the right hand of the Father. And how did that happen? By the Spirit of God. The resurrection life, that resurrection life, is our hope. Jesus is central, human and divine, combining in a way the Father and the Holy Spirit. Throughout Scripture, there are hints that God is represented in three persons, a trinity of one God, each with its own function and operation and personality in a way. God the Father did the work of creation with the Son and the Spirit. Jesus, as the Son, did the work of redemption with the Father, sent by the Father and by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is one with the Father and was given to us by Jesus. That Holy Spirit does the work of sanctification. That sanctification begins the moment we accept the work of Jesus. John goes on to tell us that Jesus was the one, full of grace and truth. And this phrase, full of grace and truth, which I so love, John 1:14, coming full of grace and full of truth. It wasn't a seesaw. If you're full of truth, you have no grace. Or if you're full of grace, you have no truth. No, Jesus came full of grace and full of truth. And so can we be that way. But that is not just a simple description of Jesus. I think it speaks very clearly of the Trinity. Jesus was not only human so that we could, each of us, identify with him completely. Jesus was also full of grace. Where does grace come from? Grace embodies the heart of the Father. That's why he gave his only begotten Son, that none should perish. That's grace. There's room for everyone in God's grace, and Jesus was the embodiment of that. And Jesus came full of truth. Truth. Where does truth reside in us? is our conduct formed in our soul, in our minds. That is where lies reside. Joys, crises of our lives reside in our souls. Where do we learn things like racism, hate, shame, and love? In our souls. Jesus embodies the truth as the Holy Spirit cleanses us of all lies and sanctifies our minds, as we like to say, Ephesians 5:26, by the washing of the water of the Word. By the washing of the water of the Word, our minds, our souls are renewed. Then John goes on to tell us, because Jesus was full of grace and truth, from him we received one gift after another. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the only Son, is very close to the Father, and he has shown us what God is like. Only through Jesus, fully human and fully divine, can we hope to understand or have an inkling of God. Jesus gave us this gift, the truth of the Trinity, and the gift of the Holy Spirit. In the book of Deuteronomy, we are told, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one, and you shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength." There is a Trinity there. See, we are triune beings. Love God with all your heart, not that organ that resides in your chest that pumps blood. No, your heart is your very spirit relating to the Father. And love the Lord your God with your whole soul or mind. And that's not that piece of gray matter and white matter and frontal lobes and cortex that resides in your skull. No, your mind, yours is your soul. Not that your mind is that very part of you that relates to the Holy Spirit. It's where we learn. The Holy Spirit is our teacher. It's where we feel anxious, and the Holy Spirit is our comforter. It relates directly to the Holy Spirit. And the Shema goes on and says, "Love God with your whole strength, your very body," representing the Son, who came in a human body. See, that command from the Old Testament called the Shema doesn't contradict the Trinity. It in fact confirms the Trinity and speaks to the mystery of the oneness of God in three persons. I think the Trinity and our feeble attempt at understanding the Trinity is so important because we must relate completely to God, wholly to God, every fiber of our being, every part of us. If we believe we are made in the likeness of God, we must believe that God is three persons in one God. And we must believe that there are three parts to us: spirit, soul, and body. And here's why. Because if God is only the Father, only a spirit, and no one has ever seen God, which we heard right from our reading today, how can we relate to this God, a spirit? It would be too unfathomable for us, too lofty, too beyond our own understanding. It'd be too foreign. And if God did not come in the flesh, how can we hope to live in these bodies and hope to live eternally? The body just dies, and then there's nothing of the body. But that is not what God wanted. From the beginning, God wanted true relationship with humankind and with the earth in which we live. We know, as we look around us, we can see the beauty of trees and forests, the beauty of sky and ocean and mountain. We see beauty all around us. We see God in the power of the sea, the ocean, and the storms that rage. We see through Jesus, true relationship is possible. Through Jesus, we have been given the gift of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is the gift that keeps on giving. For the next few weeks, we will look at all of those gifts that the Holy Spirit blesses. this church that God so imagined, the love of God's life, the church. You will get on your way out a sheet, this yellow sheet, it's a couple of pages, and it lists some of the gifts, many of the gifts, and I hope you will take this list and thoughtfully and prayerfully read it, and so that you can look at your life and see the Holy Spirit working in you and through you. There are about 31 gifts that you can discern from the Word of God, and they're not all listed here, but main ones are. I believe as you read this prayerfully, you will make a renewed commitment to offer the gifts that you have been given by the Holy Spirit, the ones that God has bestowed on you and birthed in you. I believe that those gifts will fill you to overflowing for the purpose of enriching the church. Yes, they're wonderful to have the gifts, but the gifts are designed to enrich the church, to spread the gospel. And this is what makes us different from the world. This is what makes it possible to live and move and have our being in Jesus Christ as we walk around this earth with all of its diversity and joy and sadness and coping with all the questions that we have. It is that Holy Spirit that allows us to do this. It is the gift of the Holy Spirit that fortifies us as Christians, truly, and the Holy Spirit does give gifts to the church. 1 Corinthians 12:11 says, all these are the work of one and the same Spirit. All the gifts come from the same place, from God, who distributes them to each one just as the Spirit determines. Often someone will have one gift for one moment to enrich one life. This morning I had a very detailed dream. Very detailed. Sometimes I think I don't sleep at night. If I dream, I'm really working. I'm working really hard. I am so busy in my sleep. I know you don't find that hard to believe. And this morning, it's very early, I don't know, 4 or 4:30 or something, and I was in a hospital, and I met four specific people, and each one had a very specific issue, and to each one, I had a conversation and told them something about their lives. I did not know any of these. To the last person, she was a beautiful black woman, and she had a daughter. And I said to her, you need to write a letter of apology to your daughter, because she has tears in her eyes all the time. Now, I woke up, and those four people were so emblazoned in my mind that I just prayed for them. And this is what I'm talking about with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will move you, will nudge you, will wake you, will help you go to sleep, will pray through you. That Holy Spirit is what makes us the church. Now, if you can, if you will, would you please pray with me? I'm not going to look, so if you're not led to pray, don't, but if you are, please repeat after me. Triune God, I accept what Jesus did for me. I was bought with a price, and I am no longer my own. Jesus, take the throne of my heart.
It is your rightful place.
Let nothing be above you in my life. Holy Spirit, wash my mind with your holiness.
Holy Spirit, wash my mind with your holiness.
Fill me with your Spirit.
Fill me with your Spirit.
Change me and bless me.
Change me and bless me.
With the gifts to enrich your church.
With the gifts to enrich your church.
And to minister to those who need you.
And to minister to those who need you.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen, and so be it. Now, will you join with me to sing, "It Is Well With My Soul"? It is number 561 in the hymnal. You may stand at your reading. Find their right place and realign with the word of God. those who are struggling in life's journey. So many in our list have journeys ahead of them, journeys to hospitals, journeys in cancer treatment, journeys in aging, journeys towards their eternal home. So we pray, Lord of mercy and grace, be with all of those traveling along this route. We know that you are carrying them whenever it's needed, that they are in the palm of your hand. You will never leave them or forsake them. We have this great confidence that you are full of grace and truth, and that you will shower your blessings of comfort and peace upon all of those. We pray in the name of Jesus. We pray for all of those seeking employment. We pray for those who are trying to transition into new jobs and find the right place for them. We pray, Lord, that you would lead, guide, and direct them by your Holy Spirit. Make a way. Go before them. Make the path straight. Give them wisdom, understanding, discernment, great stamina for the road ahead. We pray in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your great care that you provide through all of those who attend others, all the first responders, medical professionals, counselors, therapists, all of those that seek to serve another, whether it's making a meal or holding the hand of one going towards your eternal home, we pray that they would be strong, that they would act in grace, that they would be your heart, your hands, your feet, your very mouth, we pray in the name of Jesus. Are there others for whom we may pray? Louise?
Prayers for Bill Dan. He got a heart attack on Memorial Day. He's home, and I haven't talked to his wife, but I think he's doing reasonably well.
Thank you. For Bill Dan.
Kevin Lilly, who's recovering from traumatic brain injury after falling off scaffolding in his house. He's doing much better, but he still has headaches.
Okay.
Her friend, who is in rehab right now at his hospital stay, and we're hoping he'll go home.
Bill?
Prayers for my son, Liam. He and three of his friends are on a 10-day circulating the Great Lakes, so may they have fun and stay safe.
Amen. Others? Let's pray. Lord, we pray for Bill and Kevin and Herb. We ask that you would be with them, attend to them using the ministry of medical professionals and all that science has to bring to their need, bring health and healing to every cell in their bodies. We pray humbly in the name of Jesus. You are the God of restoration. So we cry unto you, we cry for mercy and grace, that you might be glorified in these lives, all the days of their life, that they will speak of your tender loving care. We pray in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray for Liam and his friends. Would you guide them, lead them, give them wisdom to know when to stop, when to look ahead, when to eat, when to rest. Would your bubble of protection be around them and bring them safely home. We pray in that mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Lord, you gave us every good and perfect gift. You gave us everything that pertains to life and godliness. And so it is with great confidence that we pray the words that Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power. now, friends, we have this opportunity to celebrate communion, and as we have done recently, we ask that you come forward, bring your offering, and place that in the offering plate, and then come and take communion, the very gift that Jesus gave us, his sacrifice that led us into resurrection and gave us the Holy Spirit. On that night, before Jesus was betrayed, he sat with his friends. He knew everyone. He knew them from beginning to end as God. And he knew them personally as Jesus the human. And knowing everything about them, he still gave thanks. He took the bread, lifted his eyes off of his circumstances, and broke that bread and said, "Take and eat, all of you. This is my body given for you. This is my humanity laid down for you, that you might know eternity." And after supper, he took the cup, held it out to them, and said, "Take and drink, every one of you, for this is the new covenant cut in my blood for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me, for as often as you do it, you wait for me, you speak confidence about my return. Until I come again, do this in remembrance of me." Well, let us take the bread and the cup and have the fulfillment of Jesus.
Thank you.
join me in the prayer of dedication. Take our lives and let them be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands, my voice, my silver and gold. Nothing from Thee will I withhold. Take my will and make it Yours. Take my heart from which love pours. Take myself and I will be ever only all for Thee. Ever only all for Thee. Amen. Friends, I've written the benediction that I would like you to take with you. Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Strive for full restoration. Encourage one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I bless you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace. Amen.